Nintendo.
The year is 1988, the first shots of the console wars have been fired, and Sega is making a name for itself in the video game console market. Previously a titan in the arcade scene, a decline in arcade gaming started to take a toll on the company. They would go on to sell their North American arcade manufacturing and licensing rights. The highly successful Nintendo Entertainment System, a console that revolutionized in-home video game consoles, was also near the end of its lifespan. As technology progressed, developers would soon move on from the 8-bit style and charge headfirst into the 16-bit era. After games like Super Mario Bros. 3, Legend of Zelda, and Final Fantasy had taken the video game world by storm, Nintendo quickly became a titan in the industry. However, it was time for a new era to begin, and Nintendo and Sega would pave the way for the future of the industry. Shigeru Miyamoto, who is one of the most iconic developers in video game history, ensured Nintendo was a household name, but the upstart Sega wasn't making it easy for them to keep that title. Releasing the Sega Genesis, or the Mega Drive as it was known in Japan, in 1988, Sega wanted a direct answer to, and to one-up the original NES. It featured 16-bit graphics and improved sound quality, but didn't quite take off at the beginning. It wasn't super popular in Japan due to the competition from Nintendo, who had already established themselves with the original Nintendo Entertainment System. However, it did take off in Western regions when the console released in 1989 in North America, and the Nintendo company began to take notice. Their answer was the Super Nintendo Entertainment System, or Super Famicom as it was known in Japan, which would release in Japan on November 21, 1990. It would later release in North America on August 23, 1991, when yours truly was only 3 months old. The initial beginning of the console wars is almost exactly the way it is today. If you were a kid back then, you either had a Sega Genesis or a Nintendo Entertainment System, and it was honestly up in the air what your friends had. When multiplayer was limited to on the couch instead of online, the only way you played some of the games on the market was if your friend had the opposite console and you played while you were there. I remember playing WWF Royal Rumble on Super Nintendo, but going over to a friend's house and playing Sonic the Hedgehog. Link to the Past, Donkey Kong Country, Super Mario World, everything Miyamoto touched seemed to turn to solid gold. In fact, the original console wars produced some of my greatest memories in gaming. Although Nintendo wasn't worried about it at the time of the release of the Genesis, they would soon realize their power in the industry was starting to slip. Sega's marketing scheme was one of direct opposition to the Nintendo, and would even sometimes mention them by name or snide remarks in advertising. Sega marketed themselves as the cool console to have and wanted it to be known that they supported more adult-themed titles. This was actually very present in the separate releases of the original Mortal Kombat. All the blood, gore, and brutal fatalities from the arcade version were removed from the Nintendo version, but remained in the Sega version, making it the definitive copy for adults. This series of events actually led to the creation of the Video Game Rating Council, or the Entertainment Software Rating Board that we know today. Violent video games have been a hot-button topic for decades, and didn't just begin with the more graphically intensive games of the early 2000s. Nintendo had made a name for itself as a family-friendly console, whereas Sega was more of the gritty, cool console for people of a more adult maturity. Nintendo also had a pretty strict publisher policy, but the company would drop that due to competition from Sega. However, Nintendo had some aces up their sleeves, which they would use to leverage an advantage over their direct competition. Even though Nintendo had every advantage in the world, there's one thing that they didn't have. Then CEO of Sega of America, Tom Kalinske. He was the driving force behind Sega's opposition-style marketing, undercutting the Nintendo price point, and the Sega Scream marketing campaign. During Kalinske's run, he raised the profits of the company from $72 million to more than $1.5 billion. However, unfortunately for him, Sega would begin to have a mind of their own. Despite strong opposition from Kalinske, the Saturn launched suddenly during E3 1995, but was only released in certain stores. It's odd that after so much success and forcing Nintendo to constantly compete with them, Sega decided Kalinske wasn't worth listening to about the Saturn. After all, Kalinske helped put Sega on the map in the console market and had multiplied their profits by 20 times the amount it had when he started. This decision would end up being the beginning of the end for Sega on the console scene. As Nintendo and Sega began to battle back and forth, each company also began to be recognizable for the mascots they would feature. Super Mario had already become a household name, especially after the launch of Super Mario Bros. 3. Sega needed a mascot to rival Mario and even attempt to surpass him. In steps Sonic the Hedgehog. With his simplistic design, brightly colored levels, and high-speed attitude in gameplay, Sonic quickly became a fan favorite. Releasing on June 23, 1991, exactly 2 months before the Super Nintendo would release, Sonic the Hedgehog took the platforming world by storm. Included as a pack-in with the Sega Genesis consoles in America, Sonic the Hedgehog would go on to sell 15 million copies over its lifetime, with its sequel Sonic the Hedgehog 2 selling only 6 million copies. The heat was now on Nintendo as they needed to have a strong release of their new system. Nintendo would make that strong start, as after the release of the Super NES in Japan, they would secure the rights to Street Fighter II, a game only featured in arcades at the time. It would release in Japan in June 1992, and would then release again in North America the next month. It would go on to sell the fourth highest amount of copies of any game sold on the Super Nintendo console. This was a huge victory for Nintendo, as it would take over a year for Street Fighter II to make its way to Sega Genesis. Nintendo also had the distinct advantage of having an already established mascot to sell games with. Mario is one of those brands that I would put it up there with Nike or Coca-Cola. If it's got that brand name on it, it's going to sell. Collectors everywhere wanted toys, games, and merchandise featuring everyone's favorite plumber, and Nintendo used this to great effect. This is why Super Mario World, a game that is considered one of the greatest games of all time, is the number one sold Super Nintendo game ever made. Releasing in 1990 in Japan and 1991 in America, it would go on to sell over 20 million copies. My first introduction to this game was when it was released again in 1994 as a pack-in title with Super Mario All-Stars and the Super NES system. I honestly can't tell you how many times I've beaten this game, and it's in my top 5 games of all time. For several years, Sega and Nintendo battled it out, especially in the West, but even with a 2-year head start, a wide library of games, and their own budding mascot, Sega would eventually lose the fourth generation console war. And that might be thanks to a brand new title that pushed the boundaries of what the Super Nintendo was capable of and didn't even feature everyone's favorite plumber. Donkey Kong Country released in 1994 and would once again produce a household title for the Nintendo brand. Donkey Kong had been featured in Mario games in the past, but never really took hold. Beginning his life in the arcade game Donkey Kong in 1981, he would be featured as direct opposition to Mario as he attempted to save the damsel in distress. It was developed by the Rare Company and published by Nintendo, and was in response to the more advanced consoles cropping up on the market. As the Sony PlayStation would begin to gain traction, Nintendo needed something to compete with both its rival and its future competition, and Donkey Kong Country was the answer to that. Miyamoto, the legendary creator of games like Mario, Donkey Kong, and Legend of Zelda, would oversee the project, but only in an advisory role. It would be the first Donkey Kong game that he neither directed or produced for. Donkey Kong Country would feature pre-rendered graphics, which would be one of the first titles to feature this type of design for a home console. It would go on to be the third highest-selling SNES game ever released, and stood up against games coming out on even more powerful consoles. It's actually still one of my personal favorites to go back and play all the way through from time to time. Sega would release the successful Vectorman games, releasing them in both 1995 and 1996 respectively. I actually remember when these games came out because while watching Power Rangers, the commercials and ads for the games would pop up all the time. These games became extremely popular for their run-and-gun nature, which seemed to be a theme that Sega sold very well on their consoles. After all, it was Sonic's fast-paced gameplay that led it to becoming a rival of Mario, as Western audiences preferred more flash and speed in their titles. This is something that we still see today in modern gaming, as action titles tend to fare better than slower, more deliberate titles on the market. Vectorman also came at a time where the Sony PlayStation was becoming extremely popular, and due to its disc-based technology, allowed it to feature the most powerful games on the market. However, both Sega and Nintendo had answers to this, as Nintendo released Donkey Kong Country, and Sega would release the Mega CD, or Sega CD as it was known in America. They also released the Sega 32X, which sold 2.24 million and 800,000 units respectively. This enhanced the capabilities of the Sega Genesis, allowing it to compete with the 32-bit era that was rapidly gaining traction. However, 16-bit era gaming was still a massive share of the market, and Nintendo wouldn't release a 32-bit console until its Nintendo 64 console in 1996. This would go on to become a theme of the Nintendo company, as they tend to focus less on super intensive graphics and more so on fun experiences that people can easily access but are difficult to master. While they do feature a more hardcore section of their library, titles like Mario and Legend of Zelda have stood the test of time because of their approach towards gameplay and ease of access. These games are still graphically beautiful, but don't adhere themselves to photorealism like many of their contemporaries. They feature an art style that doesn't need to be high-powered to be beautiful, and it's amazing what they've been able to do with it. What's also amazing about Nintendo is the actual lifespan of the Super Nintendo. It lasted 3 whole generations after it released, until it was finally discontinued in 2003. While Nintendo had established its brand prior to Sega's entry into the console scene, Sega still had some massive firepower when it came to selling units. Let's look at the top 5 games of both consoles and see just how crazy it is that Sega, an upstart at the time, really lit a fire under Nintendo that would be felt for generations to come. I want to look at the Super Nintendo library first, and then compare it with the titles on the Sega Genesis. Number 1, Super Mario World sold 20.61 million units sold. Super Mario All-Stars comes in at number 2 with 10.5 million, Donkey Kong Country has 9.3 million, Super Mario Kart has 8.7 million, and Street Fighter 2 The World Warrior has 6.3 million. Then we have the Sega Genesis, and of course their number 1 title is Sonic the Hedgehog with 15 million units, Sonic the Hedgehog 2 with 6 million units, Disney's Aladdin with 4 million units, Sonic the Hedgehog 3 and Sonic & Knuckles combined with 4 million units, and NBA Jam at 2 million units. Now clearly Nintendo has the advantage in sales when it comes to software, but again, we're talking about a company that already had an established brand by this point and had sold the Mario and Zelda brands to perfection before the Genesis ever arrived on the scene. I'd say that Sega definitely made a mark on the industry and did so with little notoriety behind them. Mortal Kombat 2 was a big victory for them, especially after Nintendo's censorship policy at the time held them back from hitting the adult market. It's also clear that Sonic the Hedgehog held mass appeal, especially in the Western regions, but alas, Sega was destined to eventually bow out of the console scene. They ended up relegated to publishing software and games instead of remaining a console market titan. Unlike support for the Super Nintendo lasting until 2003, Sega would abandon the Genesis in the late 90s. They discontinued the console in 1999 completely, with the Majesco version of the console only lasting 1 year from 1998 to 1999. The Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis would go on to sell 49 million and 31 million consoles respectively. Nintendo and Sega's rivalry paved the way for many of today's companies when it comes to game consoles. The first real console war drove competition in the market, and gamers reaped the benefits for generations to come. With each new console, legendary games became a staple of the video game scene, with Super Mario 64, Ocarina of Time, Final Fantasy VII, and more, all coming in the next few waves of console generations. Mario, Zelda, and Final Fantasy have gone on to be some of the best-selling franchises of all time, and they all got their starts at Nintendo. And Sega and its studios have gone on to create some of the most fun titles, including Sonic and the Yakuza and Persona series of games. While Sega has had its rocky console launches since the Genesis, they still remain a powerful force in the video game industry and have achieved continued success over the years. Nintendo's focus on more fun experiences and less on graphical output for their consoles has kept them in the spotlight and will for years to come. I've been a Nintendo fan my entire life and owned every console they've ever released, and it's their continuing drive to make phenomenal games that has kept me as a fan. We still see the impact this rivalry has had on the market, even to this day. As Sony, Microsoft, and Nintendo have all become household names in the industry, their competition has been driving games to even greater heights and inspiring several to become video game developers themselves. While Nintendo has had its missteps, a recent one being its Joy-Con drift in the Wii U, there's still a titan in the industry to this day, and it's my belief that they always will be. I have a lot of childhood memories from classics like Link to the Past, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Turtles in Time, and Super Mario World, and my love for platformers and action-adventure games only grew from there. The crazy thing is that these games are so popular, they've inspired the companies to release the new mini series of consoles preloaded with some of our favorite games. The popularity of the original run of the games has also convinced Nintendo to release games on their virtual console emulation system that we've seen on the Wii U and Switch consoles. There's still a market for these old games, and as they become harder to find and play, Nintendo seems happy to bring some of those beloved titles to modern audiences. Games like Super Mario 64, Ocarina of Time, and even Super Mario Odyssey and Breath of the Wild all exist thanks to Shigeru Miyamoto and Nintendo's hard work in the mid-80s and to the mid-90s. And we also saw the continued birth of mascots in video game companies as well, as Sony would attempt their hand at platforming greatness with Crash Bandicoot, and Microsoft would select Master Chief from the Halo series of games. A recognizable brand and mascot is the key for continued sales and success, and it's Nintendo and Sega's rivalry that birthed two of the most iconic mascots of all time. While Nintendo won the console wars of the fourth generation, Sega proved that with the right marketing, the right games, and the right drive, even industry giants can be tested. As I said before, competition drives improvement, and Sega ensured that Nintendo didn't become complacent in pushing out the same old product on the same old machine. While the Super Nintendo is one of my favorite consoles of all time, if Sega hadn't stepped up to them, it may have never existed in the first place. So thank you, Sega, for driving the market towards the future we've witnessed in the present day. You may no longer be a titan when producing consoles, but the impact you created in 1988 is still felt to this day, and we love you for it.